Pat Bohse, and this is Welcome to SCAN. I'm the executive director of SCAN, which stands for Social Community Activities Network, and SCAN provides active adults with exciting social education programs and activities, information and referral services, and we are now located not only in the Monmouth Mall, but also in Freehold Borough. I'm really excited in regards to our guest today, David Willis, who will be talking to us about scams. And I think that I'll have the opportunity to share some new unfortunate activities that happened to me recently. But David comes to us with 27 years as far as being a business reporter. He specializes in simplifying complex facts. I love that because I think KISS is my key words. Keep it simple and specific. Right. So I know that I've seen you in action, David. So I'm really excited that we'll talk more about that. So I wanted to welcome you to our show. And I really would like for you to share with the audience a little more of your background, because it's really very full of exciting opportunities that you've had in the past.
Sure. Well, thank you so much for being here. Happy to be here. I write the Press On Your Side consumer column. So I help people with problems that they might have with companies, utilities, or the cable company, or a retailer. And maybe they couldn't return something, or maybe they had a problem with their bank account or their utility bill. They got overcharged for something. So I try to help, you know, kind of mediate between them and the company.
And so you do that with the Asbury Park Press?
I do. I write my column runs on Wednesdays and Sundays, and on app.com.
And the other is that you have been a guest here at one of our Lunch and Learns.
Sure.
In the past, and we had a full house when they knew that you were coming, because I know that in many cases you've helped lots of people with a lot of the issues and when they were scammed, how to deal with it.
Right, right. So I've written a lot about scams and kind of keep up to date on the most recent kind of changes that are happening.
And what's really scary is that there's so many of them.
Well, you know, it's amazing. When I was a kid, my father would get things in the mail that says that he just won a TV set, and a big screen TV set, and all he had to do was go to Florida. And we would get that. My father just kind of, you know, brushed it off. But now people are getting things all the time, in the mail, in emails, in phone calls. So it's just exploded.
Yeah. So before we get into some of the most recent ones that we know about, especially ones that affect senior citizens, mm-hmm. is in your position, how do people get in touch with you if they're interested in talking to you or asking you for help?
Well, they can call me on the phone. My phone number is 732-643-4042. They can email me at pressonyourside@app.com. And just tell me what's happening.
Okay. So now that we got that out of the way, because I'm sure that as people listen to this particular show, they'll have lots of opportunities to think about if they were affected by a scam.
Sure.
Recently or in the past. And so I do know that one of the issues that come up when people are affected by scams is that sometimes they don't tell anybody. Mm. Sometimes they keep it to themselves, especially if they participated in it, that they're feeling uncomfortable and used and embarrassed in many cases. So let's talk about some of the ones that you're seeing. I know that there's a grandparent scam out there.
Well, one of the things I wanted to make sure I mentioned about people being ashamed about it, they really are not alone. And smart people get scammed. So it really isn't something to be ashamed about. It happens all the time. That's why scammers are out there, because it's a profitable business for them. So people should always contact a loved one, a family member, and tell them about it, because that's the people who care about them, and they should also report it to the authorities.
Okay.
So other people don't get scammed too.
And when we say the authorities, we're talking
about the
police department.
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah. So we I guess grandparent scams. These things are all over the. People are getting calls about this all the time, and it involves a call where someone pretends to be a loved one. They'll call up and they'll say hi, and you'll say, whoa, it's a, who is that? Is this Jimmy? And yes, it's Jimmy. I might not sound the same because I have a bit of a cold, but I'm caught and I got into a car accident, and eventually you'll be told that the person needs bail money or money to pay for a lawyer. And don't tell mom and dad, but I need you to help me, and I'll put my lawyer on the phone. And then there's a whole scheme of getting you to go to a store and either wire money or get an iTunes gift card. That's the latest thing. They're using iTunes gift cards.
Really?
And come back and $4,000, you know, might be $4,000. And then you hand over the numbers, and then they'll ask you for more money. Well, now I need money for my lawyer, or now I'll need money to pay for car damage. And they will come back to you multiple times and suck everything you have.
So usually when that happens or it presents itself, I mean, would a recommendation be that the person who's receiving the call their son or
Correct.
Daughter? Or
best thing to do is to just relax. Scammers want you to react without thinking. You think about it for a second and you say, hold on, thanks, I'm going to call someone. And if they say, don't call anybody, that's a clue.
Yeah.
So you call someone and you say, hey, no, Jimmy's right over there. He's in the other room. You know, that will probably be the answer you have. But nothing is so important and so should be done so quickly that you don't think about it first.
Yeah, and so we do know some people who have been scammed in regards to that.
Oh, definitely. Definitely. And these guys are so convincing that I spoke to a couple in Lenoka Harbor. They pretty much, at least the woman who got scammed, pretty much has her act together. But the guy caught her on a bad day when everything was happening and a lot of pressures. And she found out that her son-in-law was in a car accident up in North Jersey. And he was going to go to Wallway prison. And she was absolutely convinced that this was real. And it wasn't until she had lost $12,000 that she realized that maybe there's a problem.
And again, just because it happened so quickly and time is of the essence, people don't take that 2 minutes to reflect saying, so maybe not.
Yeah, maybe not. I mean, it doesn't sound quite right. I mean, nothing is so important that needs to be done right away.
Yeah.
So people should just, hang up the phone, but never give money over the telephone.
Okay, or credit card information.
If someone wants money right now, that's a real problem.
Okay, that should be a high sign.
Yeah, that's a high sign, a flag.
Do you ask them for a phone number to call them back?
They'll probably give you one.
Okay.
You know, I mean, the scammers say, they call us back when you get the gift cards.
Got
and
it.
You call them back and you read off the numbers on the back, or you say that here's the number for the wire transfer or whatever fake thing that they ask you for.
Okay. So that's the grandparents one.
That's the grandparents one.
So what's the next one?
So the next one, which is sweepstakes scams.
Ah.
So there's someone calls you up on the phone and they say you just won second prize in the grand sweepstakes. It's never first prize. It's always second prize. Because the first prize person already got their money. So now it's your turn to win. But first you got to send them some cash. Either a wire transfer or a gift card or whatever. And people, they say, well, what's that? What's giving $800 or $400 when I'm going to win $2 million? So they give. Then they get another call that says, well, now there's another fee you got to pay. Another fee. And so the key of that is you never give money to win money. So when someone calls you on the phone and says you won money, you didn't win money.
Yes.
Period.
Period.
Every single time. And with that, you just hang up the phone.
Right. And I do know of several seniors who are members of SCAN who family members have been scammed in regards to the sweepstakes.
Yep.
And they just refuse to believe that it's a scam. They've provided them some cash and they're asking for additional, dollars after the initial money is sent to them, because now they're on the hook.
Correct. And once a scammer gets his hooks into you, they won't stop until you don't have any money left.
Right. And I'm talking about they went to the authorities, they even changed the gentleman's phone number, and they were still able to contact them through other sources.
I've talked to people who the families have changed their phone numbers. They've taken away their ability to get mail because while when you get caught with one of these phone scams, all of a sudden you get a lot of mail scams too. So they're going to shut the mail off, they shut off the telephone, they removed access to the bank accounts. They've taken all their jewelry away because, and they don't have any cash either because some of these people will say, just send a $20 bill. So they'll send out $20 bills to people.
Wow.
So it's really devastating, frankly.
And I think that when they had done some research on it, came from overseas, the scam.
A lot of them are overseas. I would have said, let's talk about IRS scams today. But recently, the authorities in India busted a big ring of IRS scammers who were calling up people in the U.S. and saying that the IRS were coming to get them. The Better Business Bureau and AARP recently told me that people seem to be getting less of those calls. Still worry about them. The IRS never calls you on the phone to call you and demand money. They don't threaten to arrest you. They especially don't tell you how to pay a bill. So hopefully those calls are getting less.
And if you get one of those, basically just hang up.
Hang up the phone. You always just hang up. You don't hit one or hit two. You don't try to give them the what for. Because that really doesn't do anything for you. And it tells people that you're alive.
And well.
So they'll just alive and well, and you'll just keep calling.
Yeah.
So you get more calls. And plus, these guys are criminals.
They are.
So you really don't want to deal with them.
And they're scary.
They're very scary. So that woman who got hit for $12,000 with the grandparents scam, when she did go to the police called the scammers up on the phone and says, okay, you got what you needed. Don't talk to her anymore. They still called. And this time, they had an air horn. So when she answered the phone, they gave her a shot of the air horn in her ear.
Wow.
So, I mean, we're just not talking about nice people.
Yeah.
So best to just hang up the phone.
So we're going to take a break in about another minute. And then when we come back, I do want to talk about the internet because we're doing a lot of technology training.
Great.
For seniors. Again, it's amazing how many scams are out there on the internet. And people they look so real that people don't understand that. So we're going to be back in a minute with David Willis, the wonderful reporter in regards to protecting you against scams.
So if you're over 65, like me,
and active and fairly healthy,
being active and healthy alone will not protect you.
Remember, the immune system weakens with age.
And if you're over 65, ask your doctor about your vaccination options.
We want you to be healthy and active.
Welcome back. My name is Pat Bohse, and my guest today is David Willis from the Asbury Park Press, and he is the business editor and writer for Press on Your Side.
Right.
And we're talking about scams. So we've already talked about two of them that are pretty prevalent, one being scams against grandparents, which is important to us, and then also the sweepstakes scams. And so we're going to talk now about the internet because, as you know, everybody is being asked to use technology for everything and anything in the world, but there's also the dark side sometimes in regards to the internet. So tell us some of the things that we should be looking out for.
Well, one of the things that I look for in my own life, and everyone should too, is scam emails. So suppose you get an email from Verizon, and you have a Verizon account, and it says you owe $450. And your service is about to be shut off. You should be really careful because it's most likely that email is a scam. What scammers do is they take companies that you would do business with, like your bank or your utility or your phone company, and they make emails that look exactly the same. And they say that you're in big trouble, your bank account's about to be closed, to get you to click on the links in there. and that'll take you to a fake website, and then you put all your bank account information in and your credit card numbers in, and what you're doing is just giving it to the scammers. So the key thing is to not respond to those. Delete them. And if you have an email that says that you have a problem with your bank account, you call your bank up on the telephone.
Absolutely.
And you ask them. And you don't call the number that's in the email.
Right.
You call the number that's on your statement, your bank statement.
Right.
And that brings up the fact of, that with the internet, you can do all sorts of things. You can check your bank statements. You can check your credit card statements. You should be doing that all the time, not just when your statement comes in the mail. Always check, because that will tell you if you're having a problem.
Yeah, and again, I think that it becomes a little scary. I mean, I'm internet savvy.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not necessarily proficient. I don't bank online.
Okay.
I think I have that little fear to do that.
Right.
But I do think that people need to understand that they have to be proactive versus reactive to something like that. Like you just said,
right.
Instead of addressing that in that particular email, they need to delete it and then call whoever the source is to confirm.
Right, one of the most important things besides not clicking on links in emails is you never click on an attachment in the email. It could be a scam email from a family member. And it says, I've got some great photos for you. And it has the photos and the attachment. You don't click on those, because what that could do is it could download a virus into your computer. And what that virus could do is it could scour your hard drive for your passwords. It could copy everything you've typed, including your password information, and send it to a scammer. And it could just really mess things up. So if you do get an email from someone that looks like your grandkid, you call up your grandchild and say, did you send me that email with that photo, with those photos in it?
Yeah.
So you confirm it before you start looking at things.
Absolutely.
The worst case, that could be what's called ransomware, and that could wipe out everything in your computer.
Or, again, that happened to my business, and when we went to go get some files, they were all X's.
Encrypted.
Yes. And so there was a whole ransom conversation, which I did not continue to have the conversation with them. We did call our technology specialist, and they had to wipe out a lot of stuff and
reboot it.
Yes.
Yeah, I mean, you're...
So either way, it cost me money.
It did, and you know, some people end up paying because they don't want to lose all their data, but in the meantime, it's probably best, you're essentially taking a hammer to your computer because all your data is gone unless you pay. And there's a whole debate, which we won't have here, as to whether you should pay or not.
Exactly.
But it really is damaging. So the best thing is not click on email, not click on attachments.
Absolutely. And so no one in my office can do that anymore.
Right.
But there's so many of that. And the whole issue around the scams, and I just want to get into how come people don't report them as often as they should. It really comes down to feeling used and abused in a lot of cases. And I understand people being concerned that they might be looked at as, you know, not having the ability to see through the trees, see the road through the trees. But I do want to share, and I did share this with you, that I was recently scammed. Mm. And so all of the things that you were just saying in regards to people who are intelligent, kind of know what they're doing and stuff like that, can still be victims of this. And this,
they're pros.
Absolutely. I mean, you want to talk about the emotions? I've gone through all of them in the last 2 weeks. I mean, saying like, oh my God, how stupid could you be?
Right.
To the point where I don't want to get in my car anymore because I don't feel safe. And so my particular scam happened in New York City. I was coming from a conference and I have an older car. And so I was having some issues to begin with. And there was a gentleman in another car saying, your car is smoking. And then I said, okay. And really knew that might be happening.
Mm-hmm.
And then I said to myself, let me just get through the tunnel. So if I needed to be if I needed to be towed, I'd be in New Jersey versus New York. So I made the turn, and there was another gentleman at the other side of the turn, and he said, your car is smoking. And so I did pull over because I was getting nervous that it might blow up and go on fire. And one thing led to another in regards to them opening the hood and telling me about the plugs were popped, and I must have hit a speed bump and all of this other stuff, and proceeded to put some water in my car. Nothing exciting here. And I was just so nervous because the car was not well to begin with, and I wanted to get home, that after being scammed and probably making it so easy for them, I lost $350 cash. Wow. They wanted me to, it was so funny because they even said, you need to go pay on a credit card at the bank. And he kept pushing that. And I said, so don't you take cash? So, of course, he said yes. So he must have gotten us early Christmas present.
Sure.
But by the time I got home, I did get home. I if nothing else, he gave me the ability to feel safe for an hour that I could get home.
Right.
I did get home. Right. And as a result of that, the next day my car actually died, and I will not drive it because I don't feel safe. But for the last 2 weeks, I've just been beating myself up saying, how stupid could you be?
Well, I mean, what the guy essentially did is he looked at your car and he said, well, maybe that car has a problem. So he thought that maybe the person driving it would think it has a problem. So you were a good target. They do the same thing with computers. The guy calls you up on the computer and says, you have a virus on your computer. And you say, well, maybe my computer burped. I might have a problem. So they get you off guard just a little bit, and then it just goes on from there.
So so action steps is I've done nothing to date. After talking to you, I will make an official complaint to the police department in
yep.
New York City
yep.
so that they could be aware of that. I mean, in my heart of heart, I want to go back there and just watch to see if they do it again, but that's not a smart move.
No.
So I won't do that. But really, I mean, so anybody is open to this, no matter, you know, who you are, not age specific or anything,
yep.
male, female, but it's important to really try to stop them in their tracks.
Exactly. And phone scammers really are just blasting out phone numbers all at once until they get somebody.
So do we call that phishing?
Well, phishing is, it is with a PH. Phishing is with the emails, where they're phishing for your private information.
Right. And so once they get that, there's...
They're off to the races.
Yeah. And so what can we do if we were scammed? So let's talk about some of the pro-action things that one can do.
Sure. Well, if you are scammed, you should call the police department, first of all, and file a police report. And even if there's really no hope of getting your money back, they might have... What they'll do is they'll take your information and they'll pass it along the law enforcement chain. You know, there are people that are dealing with this all the time. If you've gotten hit with a sweepstakes scam and you've fallen for it, you're going to need to take care of your junk mail, because you're going to be hit with a lot of scams. So you need to call the postal inspectors up to do that, and they will help you deal with the aftermath of getting hit. But you also need to go to the FTC. The FTC has, the Federal Trade Commission has a whole, on their website, ftc.gov, a whole bunch of things you can do to deal with your identity theft issues, by putting a freeze on your credit report so that no one can open up accounts in your name, and then contacting all the credit agencies, the three credit bureaus, to deal with kind of taking your information back.
So the three credit bureaus,
right.
We should be going to them at least once a year to get reports.
You can get a free credit report once a year from each of the bureaus. And that will tell you if you have a problem. You'll be able to see all the debts you have, the bank accounts you have, and whether anything's been opened up in your name and you don't know about it. And then you can fix each one of those.
Yeah, and that's really important. Because most
really
people
important.
Don't do that.
Really, really important.
Right, and it's free, so it's not an issue that that it would cost money. It would take some time. And it takes some time to review it. But once you get it, and if there is discrepancies, you can have them
corrected. You can deal with that, correct.
Great. So we're excited. So we have about one more minute left. So is there any words of wisdom that you would like to leave with our audience in regards to you, your services, how to get in touch with you if they need help or SCAN?
Well, people can, as I said, people can call me at 732-643-4042. But one of the things that I would most like people to remember is just to kind of be aware of what's going on with their own financial life. So they need to check their bills. You need to check your bank account. Even if you can't do it online, just have, you know, make sure you know what's happening, that you read your statement, your bank statements every month.
Yes.
And that you, because I've talked to people who have found charges on things, but they find it 5 months later. And when it'd been much easier if they had been checking their statements and not just paying the bill.
I agree. And so, again, I want to thank you for being our guest. This is a really important topic for us. We're going to be doing more conversation around it here at
Terrific.
SCAN and in this coming year, because it's just really important for people to feel safe, and be proactive versus reactive mm-hmm. to something negative happening to them. So I would like to take this opportunity and thank our guest, David Willis, and then also invite anyone to come into SCAN. We're located in the basement of the Monmouth Mall, and visit us, take a tour, see the classes that we have available, and hopefully you'll become part of our family. Thank you.
Thanks, Pat.
Thank you.